thorium is a little bit lighter element than uranium. Uranium is element number 92, and thorium has two less protons, so it's element number 90. It's a so-called fertile material. It means that it can't fission directly. Uranium can fission directly, but thorium can capture neutrons in a reactor and become a type of uranium, and an isotope of uranium that can fission and release energy.
When a nucleus absorbs a neutron, the nucleus can split into fission fragments, and that is fission, or the nucleus can retain the neutron and through radioactive decays can become another element. And this is the case of the so-called fertile species. For example, when thorium-232 absorbs a neutron, it can become uranium-233. So uranium-233, like plutonium-239, are fissile species. They do not exist in nature, and they can be generated in a nuclear reactor as new fuels.
The reactor concept that would have converted thorium into uranium-233 was never taken much beyond rough conceptual design. Where did Oak Ridge National Laboratories, ORNL as it is now called, fit in the country's quest for civilian nuclear power? Since industry was developing civilian nuclear power based on Rickover's technology, the national laboratories should pursue the long-term possibilities. It was in this spirit that the Homogeneous Reactor Experiment, HRE, a partial prototype of the liquid fuel reactor, was planned. In a light water reactor, the core consists of solid fuel elements.
The uranium oxide was processed and made into pellets. Almost 700,000 of these pellets would be loaded into the reactor's core.
These elements deteriorate under neutron bombardment.
At the beginning of its life, nuclear fuel looks like this. These are very nicely shaped, very regular cylindrical pellets, and they are stacked up inside these metallic rods. During its life in the reactor, the fuel experiences a large number of fissions. Fissions means that some nuclei of the fuel are split and become different elements. The accumulation of the fission products, together with the thermomechanical solicitation due to the fact that the material becomes really hot because of the fission, generate a lot of changes. You see here the appearance of nuclear fuel after irradiation. The main feature that you can observe here is that the fuel is heavily cracked, and the consequence in terms of the performance of the fuel is that, for example, the thermal conductivity, so the capacity of the material to transport heat out of the pellet and into the coolant, might be degraded.
The elements will have to be replaced periodically, say when only 10% of the fuel has fissioned. Thus, to completely burn 100% of the fuel elements will have to be recycled 9 times. ORNL espoused an approach that avoided this expensive recycling. Eliminate solid fuel elements entirely. Replace the solid fuel elements with a solution of uranium in heavy water. Gone would be the thousands of carefully machined uranium slugs. Gone, too, the intricate system of piping required to feed water into each process tube.
With a liquid fuel, you don't need to make fuel elements and worry about the cladding being able to contain the fuel and the fission products safely.
Huh? Oh my! That's Sid Ball! And Dick Engel on the left. We used to work together in ORNL.
Solid fuel reactors and where you can't remove the fission products, the afterheat is a problem that you need to address if you have a shutdown, because even if it's just a few percent of the total power, that for a big reactor, that can be a lot of megawatts that have to be cooled. Yeah. I mean, you have to account for that in order to keep the reactor from getting too hot. And of course, that's true of just about every reactor we got.
And that's true, particularly in the cases where there have been loss of cooling accidents, such as Fukushima, which is a classic example of a system that became overheated, got so hot, the cladding on the fuel elements got so hot that it reacted with steam to produce the hydrogen, which led to the explosions and all the rest of the things.
That's known as a Zirkaloy water reaction, which is, of course, well known, and which is the reason why the water reactors are very careful about being able to cool to the point where this reaction doesn't take place. And that's what happened at Fukushima.
With the liquid fuel approach, we eliminated solid fuel elements, which even today are often a source of trouble.
We were quite proud of that system. It operated very reliably, except...
I can still remember our feeling of elation. We youngsters at Oak Ridge, the average age of the crew in the control room was barely 30. Look at me. We youngsters had succeeded in one of the most difficult nuclear engineering tour de force, the stable operation of a high-power density liquid-fueled reactor.
This is the operation of HRE-1, the aqueous system. And in that system, there was a steam turbine for generating electricity. And this is some of the first electricity generated by nuclear power.
When Enrico Fermi's first ever reactor achieved criticality in Chicago in 1942, they raised a toast with a bottle of Chianti. So when our HRE fed the grid, I said, when piles go critical in Chicago, they celebrate with wine. When piles go critical in Tennessee, we celebrate with Jack Daniels.
Well, the aqueous system drew quite a lot of attention. We had visitors from all over the place coming in, looking at the system.
During the time the HRE was online, Jack Kennedy, then Senator Kennedy, visited Oak Ridge.
Alvin, this is a picture of you hosting Senator Jack Kennedy and his wife, Jackie, at the HRT. And it looks like you're doing a good job of convincing them that it's money well spent.
We regarded HRE-1 as a tremendous success. I was therefore taken aback when I realized that Washington hardly shared our enthusiasm. The homogeneous reactor operated for 105 days before it was closed down. But I became bitten with the liquid fuel bug, a fixation I've never fully recovered from.
If you're a craftsman, you might make lots of different kinds of shelves or cabinets or so on, but there's going to be a particular kind that you're especially fond of.
That's Richard,
mm-hmm.
My son.
And Alvin had a special fondness for first his homogeneous reactor and then his molten salt reactor, which was sort of a further development of the same basic concept. And he, I think, became deeply attached to that.
Oh, Richard. Well, my next connection with liquid fuel reactors was, of course, here in Oak Ridge, when the laboratory was diverted from civilian reactors to once more indulge the military.
So in the post-war years, the dilemma still exists. How do you cope with the difference between the civilian atom, or perhaps you could call it the atom for peace, and the atom for war? And they created all these incredible ideas, particularly within the military, because that's where the money was. So you should not only have a submarine powered by nuclear power, but you should also have an icebreaker powered by nuclear power. But the particular one which astonishes everybody, if you would tell them about it today, because it was so long ago, is the nuclear aeroplane.
This Air Force whim for a nuclear aeroplane was hardly regarded as respectable by us at Oak Ridge.
First of all, there would have been a lot of problems with shielding, heavy shielding in a plane for people, especially for long term, to be flying around with a reactor nearby. Unlike the, say, the submarine, where you can put in a lot more shielding and not have to worry about keeping it up in the air. And also the concern about the thing crashing somewhere. Planes do crash. And if the reactor crashed, it would be sort of messy and hard to explain.
But the Air Force had too much political strength to allow the nuclear airplane to be ignored.
So from 1946 to 1961, they still worked on this airplane. And everybody knew, the engineers knew, working on it, that this was just a completely crazy idea. But it was driven by Strategic Air Command, who thought, what could be finer than dropping a nuclear bomb from a nuclear airplane?
So, with strong congressional support, the Air Force launched its own Nuclear Energy for Propulsion Aircraft project in Oak Ridge.
The primary goal was to produce the 1600 degree, well, that was Fahrenheit, 900 degrees Celsius temperatures that are required to power a nuclear aircraft.
But how could twig-like fuel elements retain their integrity at a temperature of 1600 Fahrenheit? The damn fuel elements will come out looking like a bunch of spaghetti. We tried to visualize a reactor that was not a Swiss watch operating at red heat. This naturally led us to the notion of liquid fuel. Reactors that would have no solid fuel elements to be deformed. But what liquid fuel was stable at 1500 Fahrenheit? Water, like in the previous homogeneous reactor, wouldn't work. The temperatures required by the jet exceeded the aqueous system's limits. The answer was molten salts. Of course not kitchen salt, but molten fluorides of the alkali metals in which uranium fluoride was dissolved.
Much like one might dissolve sugar into water, one can dissolve thorium or uranium into the molten salt.
I prepared a small demonstration to show you the two possible states of a molten salt. At the beginning, you will see how it behaves when it's molten, at the temperature which corresponds to operational temperature of molten salt reactor. So let's have a look. As you see, it's perfectly transparent, it's liquid, and very easily can be moved through the primary circuit and heat exchangers of the reactor.
Thus began Oak Ridge National Laboratory's 25 years love affair with molten salts.
There are several key advantages to a molten salt reactor, and they all trace back to the innate stability of the salt form. When two elements are formed as a salt, they're very chemically stable.
Yeah, there's nothing in the world more stable than fluorides or chloride salts. They're just impossible to kind of split apart. So they're very stable, like sodium chloride. Sodium is dangerous on its own. Chlorine is dangerous on its own. Sodium chloride together is table salt. So they're just very stable entities to work with in general.
This allows them to operate at high temperatures and yet at low pressures. A nuclear reactor needs to operate at high temperatures in order to generate electricity, but it's undesirable to operate at high pressures because of safety concerns. Using molten salt as a fuel, on the other hand, it is possible to operate at very high temperatures, yet still at low pressures.
In a molten salt reactor, the molten salt doesn't boil until 1500 or 1800 degrees Celsius. So you don't need to put it under pressure, so you can use the molten salt as it is at normal pressure.
Secondarily to that is the complete lack of driving force. You run these reactors at low pressure. Nothing's trying to really burst out. You don't use water in the reactor so that there's no possibility of a steam explosion. And there's nothing that can make a chemical potential. There's nothing that can make hydrogen production, like unfortunately we saw at Fukushima. Just really nothing that's going to push that out.